Hey everyone, this is Sanjukta. You are watching my video blogs. Please keep subscribing to my channel and keep sharing all my videos. I have been uploading various political video blogs talking about the current Indian politics, and I have been also regularly uploading the online tutorials for women and gender studies, specifically keeping in mind the syllabus used in various Indian colleges for women and gender studies master course, as well as an extra elective course for undergraduate students. So today in my video blog, I am going to talk about the origin of media, or the idea of democracy, or the idea of freedom of speech and individual rights. Where did these come from? So let us begin by, why do we call the media as the fourth estate? Why is journalists or press called the fourth estate of democracy, the fourth pillar of democracy? Where did this come from? It all started in the 17th century, when it was the time of enlightenment and scientific revolution across Europe. Germany, Britain, France, primarily these countries, and the urban cities in these countries, so Paris, London, these places. It started with the bourgeois society. What is bourgeois society? The elite class in these states and these countries at that time, which was the business people, the academics, professors, you know, scientists. It was the time when humans, you know, on the civilizational calendar, it was a time when people were coming out of the you know, theological knowledge. Before this time, people used to only believe in religion or whatever is written in the, you know, in the holy books. But this was the time in Europe when enlightenment was happening, so people were discarding anything, any knowledge which was given to them from the top by the king or the church, and they were taking to scientific rationalization and facts, fact finding, and all those kind of, you know, rational knowledge, and not just knowledge that was given, not given knowledge, not received knowledge, but knowledge that they could understand or acquire through reason and their own perceptions of hearing, thinking. One of the most prominent proponents of this time was Immanuel Kant, who said that we humans always look for tutelage. It is the word from which the word tutor come. Tutelage means that we more or less know what is right and what is wrong, what is should be done, what need should not be done, but we are never sure unless we hear it from our peers, somebody else comes and tells us. And that's from there we also get that herd mentality. People tend to do what everybody is doing and are never sure about their own knowledge and understanding, because they think, oh, but nobody else is saying that, then I must be wrong. But Kant said, and this is why we need more and more people who have knowledge, who have reason, to come out into the public space and share their knowledge. So that is how, in the bourgeois society of the 17th century, the public sphere was imagined and formed. It was a space, it actually both a physical space and also a space in the sense like magazines and journals and pamphlets. So both. And what was the physical space? Physical space was like coffee houses. There were table societies in Germany. There were coffee houses in London. And then there were salons in France. These were called private, public spheres. It so happened that all these scientific people with scientific knowledge or reason, who were questioning any received knowledge that was given to them by the church or the king, and they end with starting to talk about matters of public importance in the public sphere, that is the coffee house or the saloons, to question the authority, which was the church or the monarch. The very idea of these conversations that was happening in a public sphere like coffee house was to question the authority. These public spheres were open to all, so long as they were able to spend that money to enter the coffee house or buy a coffee. It did not need somebody to be of nobility. It didn't have somebody, it didn't need, require somebody to be of, any royalty or any other legacy. It allowed anybody who had reason, who had something to talk about, something to share. Now, of course, it was still limited to people who could read, write, people who were urban, people who had money. So it was still not fully open to every member of the society. That is a genuine criticism of the public sphere that has been theorized. And this theory that I'm telling you about comes from Jürgen Habermas. He was a German philosopher, and he gave us this, he conceptualized this, that this is how media and public sphere came into being. So of course, public sphere, these coffee table societies were not fully democratic, in the sense that the rural people were not participant in that, and people of color were not participants. Women were present in the French salons, and they played a good role, quite a powerful role in those French salons, but they were not present in the London coffee houses. But to a certain extent, these societies, these public sphere, was open to all. And the primary task of these places, these conversations, was to question authority. From there, let the idea of freedom of speech, to be able to say something which had reason and logic and possibly questioned all kinds of authorities, like the existence of God, the church, the monarch, was allowed. These things took time to about 100, 200 years to fully evolve into what we today understand of media. But this was the beginning of the idea that the king will not rule as per his whims and fancy. The church will not make rules as per their whims and fancies or as per what they understand the religion to be, but that the power of these authorities, that is the king and the church, would come from public opinion. These coffee tables and these table societies and these salons, they formed a public opinion. This public opinion had to approve the power of the king. And that's where the entire idea of fourth estate or press, as the entity which keeps a check on powers that be, came into existence. These public sphere, these enlightenment conversations that happened in public sphere, then led to the French Revolution, which gave us the democracy, the idea of nation states that we now today have. So taking that to the logical, progress to what we now today have, is that the media's primary job is to always question the authority, that is the ruling government and the ruling party. In the Great Britain, during the 18th century, after these public spheres emerged and the public opinion emerged, and it was fully understood in the societies, in the bourgeois societies, that the king just cannot do anything that he pleases, and the king has to follow what the public wants, what the public demands. Of course, these were not fully evolved. At that time, the public was still very masculine. They didn't understand women's rights. They didn't understand black people's rights. But for their time, they still had this much understanding that public will decide what would be the power of the king. In like I was saying, in Great Britain, when there were these two parties, the Tories and the Whigs, it was just assumed that the public opinion or the public sphere or the journalists, one of the earliest journalists, journalism people in the world, which emerged during this period, it was assumed that they will by default always be against the government. No matter what the government does, they will question and criticize the government. It was assumed that whoever has power, that is the king, the government, the parliament, the church, whoever has power is on the wrong side and they need to be constantly grilled and constantly criticized. And whoever does not have power, which is the opposition party and the people, are always the virtuous, the dignified. They has to be given respect and they has to be taken more seriously. This idea of the public opinion or public criticism of the powers that be continued for the longest time in civilizational history. Till the 90s, late 90s, till the time we got internet, till the time late 90s or even early 2000s, we continued having this. But of course, media, TV media has been taken over by government, has been controlled, has been politicized, political parties have used it for their benefit. All of that is true. It has happened throughout the world. But at the core of the idea of media as a fourth estate, this remains the core, that they will always criticize the power. What we today see in the Indian context, that a large number of the Indian television media are very soft and respectful towards the government, particularly the Prime Minister Modi. They will not raise their voice when it comes to questioning the government. First of all, they don't question the government. If at all they do, they are very mellowed and very careful in their words. They are always saying Modi ji, respected Modi ji, and they are always trying to, you know, portray Mr. Modi and the ruling party in the best possible light. And at the same time, they are also continuously berating the opposition, using very derogatory terms for the opposition leaders like Rahul Gandhi. They are constantly creating programs with the sole purpose of undermining what the opposition is raising, any issue that the opposition is raising. Channels like Times Now, Republic, they spend hours, like 2-3 hours of their prime time television network television program in dismissing the opposition narratives. It just seems very, very bizarre. It has something that the world has not seen anywhere. Maybe they might have seen it in North Korea or, I don't know, Uganda or whatever, you know, these kind of very weird dictatorships. But this has never happened in any democracy, in any progressive democracy, that the media is going an extra length to protect the government and the same media is going an extra length to undermine, to dismiss the opposition. This is very worrying for our future. Tomorrow, what kind of journalism that we are going to teach to our young students if they want to take up journalism as a profession? The journalist's job is to A, raise people's issue, B, question the government. If they don't want to do anything with the opposition, that is their call. They may not support the opposition. But they should not go an extra length to defend the government. That is something that we all the time see today happening in India. And I will give you an example for today, from today. Today, Rahul Gandhi's and Priyanka Gandhi's visit to Hathras, the second attempt that they were making to visit Hathras, was presented on CNN News 18 with very problematic headlines. One of the headlines said that Rahul Gandhi is again doing drama. Another headline said Rahul Gandhi's attempt to visit has flopped yet again. This headline they made in the afternoon when Rahul Gandhi was still in the car going to Hathras. How can his attempt already flop when he was still approaching Hathras? And in the morning, Rahul Gandhi has actually given a very powerful statement that no matter what force in the world, nobody would be able to stop me from going to Hathras. And everybody knows that he will do it because he has done it before. He has done it in Bhatta Persol. He has done this Houdini act. Nobody knew where he went. He simply disappeared from the eyes of the UP police and reached straight to the village where he wanted to go in Bhatta Persol. So obviously, in the morning, the statement he made was taken very seriously by UP government, and therefore UP government by the afternoon actually allowed entry to Rahul Gandhi, Priyanka Gandhi and three more MPs from Congress party. And by the evening around 8 o'clock they reached Hathras, and the other headline on India Today was that Rahul Gandhi's second bid to reach Hathras is successful. So clearly, CNN 18 is playing the game of the ruling party, which wants to simply, for no reason, for no justification, wants to put Rahul Gandhi in a bad light by using very judgmental terms like he's doing drama, and by saying that he has flopped already, which is not even factually correct because he succeeded. He did go to Hathras, and the UP administration had to bend. They had to fold. So you can clearly see the kind of pathetic journalistic standards that we are seeing in India, and this is just not acceptable. And I say this not because I am the critique of the ruling regime, not because of any other not because I support the liberal left liberal parties like Congress, but because I'm worried about what kind of democracy are we building where the journalism as a fourth estate is completely decimated. What are you going to, if tomorrow your children are going to take up journalism as a profession, what are you going to tell them? The work of the journalist, the duty of the journalist is to question authority. What are we going to teach them? Are we going to tell them that you would be constantly undermining the opposition and protecting the government? This is something that we all should think. Thank you for watching today's video blog. Please subscribe to my channel again. Keep sharing and keep spreading the word. Click on the bell icon, and I will see you the next time on another political blog. Thank you so much.